Recorded Books presents Empowering Black Boys to Challenge Rape Culture by Gordon Braxton. Narrated by Beresford Bennett. Prologue. The lives of the boys who you know will almost certainly be touched by sexual violence. Boys may come to know this violence as they respond to a daughter, friend, sister, or spouse who has survived it. They may come to know it as they interact with other boys and men who have perpetrated it. They will likely come to know it as the media and their colleagues pass on lessons about it. They may even come to survive it or perpetrate it themselves. So, why do we not talk to them about sexual violence when they will surely see its influence as they look back on their journeys into manhood? Whether we are unequipped, afraid, or unaware of the urgency of the problem, we spend little to no time empowering boys to raise their voices against sexual violence. That leaves them in the hands of a world that minimizes and normalizes it. I did not learn to raise my voice until concerned teachers pulled me aside and asked me to help. You too can extend an invitation to the boys in your life. In a better world, they will know the following. 1. They will recognize that they personally know survivors of sexual violence, even though these survivors may not disclose themselves. 2. They will learn that how they react to these survivors could have a huge impact on their well-being. 3. They will recognize that they also know perpetrators. Violent men are rarely masked outcasts, and how boys react to them may go a long way in determining how these men perceive their actions. 4. They will understand that ensuring that they do not perpetuate violence themselves requires more than just understanding that no means no. 5. They will accept that not being personally violent does not excuse them from caring about a brand of violence that affects hundreds of thousands. 6. They will recognize that they are free to break from the manly choices pre-selected for them. For starters, they will know that it is acceptable to be upset by violence, even though society does not always give boys and men permission to admit this. 7. They will see that breaking from traditional expectations of men can bring its own rewards. 8. They will realize that others may come to stand with them when they decide to stand against violence. When they do, they will be joining a global community of concerned women and men who seek to eradicate sexual violence. 9. They will see that there are many ways that they can use their voices to help. To name a few, they can interrupt comments and attitudes that diminish the seriousness of sexual violence, treat survivors with dignity, develop strategies for ensuring consent in their own lives, and challenge their peers to do the same. 10. They will understand that it may take time and practice to become effective at sharing their voices. 11. They will believe that rape and sexual assault do not have to exist, and that boys and men can play a critical role in ending them. Introduction. I once presented to the senior class of a prestigious all-boys school in New York City. I was talking to them about how we can prevent sexual assault, and one young man in the back of the room stood up and exclaimed how it was pointless for men to discuss such things since it all boiled down to women choosing to be responsible. I geared up to push back because I believed that men and boys have a role to play in preventing violence, but settled down after seeing one of the young man's peers respond. He raised his hand rather tentatively, but was far from bashful once I gave him the floor. He told the audience about how he had a friend who had experienced a terrible assault and how he wished that he could have done more to help her. His peers followed his lead, and a steady stream of young men rose to voice how they could help. The direction of the conversation changed entirely because one young man had the courage to speak up. Even the student who initially sparked the conversation with his comment about women needing to take responsibility walked up to me after the program and told me that he had spoken clumsily. He wanted to help. If we get past the stereotypes of young men and give them a space to speak, we might be surprised at the leadership potential waiting to be channeled. I am so thankful that somebody once asked me to help. That invitation changed the course of my life in ways that I am still learning. I do not think that there is too much that stands out about me were you to pass me on the street. Get to know me, and you will find out that I was raised in Virginia and have lived in the Philadelphia, Boston, Los Angeles, and Washington, D.C. areas since graduating from college. My mother very much wanted a little girl, but instead ended up with three knucklehead boys, of which I am the oldest. But ask me how I spend my time and things will start to get interesting. I have spent the last 2 decades of my life speaking about sexual violence prevention in some fashion or another. It started when I was introduced to the field as an undergraduate student, found that I had a passion for it, and made it a personal mission to speak up. Following college, I accepted an invitation from a prominent speaker on survivor advocacy. She was looking for a man of color to accompany her on a speaking tour of public schools. I joined her and went on to speak to secondary schools, colleges, military units, and community-based organizations. From there, I became a prevention specialist at Harvard University, where I was able to address sexual violence from a student affairs perspective. At the same time, I worked alongside statewide and national coalitions, which allowed me to better understand the effects of public policy on the perpetration of violence. Throughout it all, I had the great opportunity to hear from thousands of young men. I have a more conventional office job these days, but still regularly find myself in conversation with coworkers and acquaintances regarding some aspect of sexual violence in the news or in somebody's personal life. I was not always this concerned about sexual violence and would have found this topic to be off limits 20 years ago. Sexual violence was not something that I thought about, and it certainly was not something to be discussed. Even though I was blessed to have many adults in my life who cared about me, I cannot recall a single adult saying anything meaningful to me about sexual violence before I entered college. Our culture does not consider talking to boys about rape to be a vital life lesson. Any education I did receive on the subject came from conversations in the school cafeteria, references in pop culture, and news media discussing the alleged actions of celebrities and politicians. I am not alone in this. Many boys will mature well into adulthood without having a constructive conversation about the presence of rape and sexual assault in the world. This does not mean that they do not want to talk. In my experience, boys always have something to say and questions to ask when given the chance to share. They are waiting for an opportunity to unleash their fears, flesh out their viewpoints, and confront their anxieties about the violence that they know exists in the world and the policies surrounding it. They recognize that sexual violence is relevant to their lives, but so few adults ever take the time to give them a space to process complicated concepts and develop their values. We avoid this responsibility because we might see sexual violence as rare, as something that is relegated to the nightly news and does not warrant any further discussion. Others of us are well aware of the scope of sexual violence, but do not realize that there is anything to be done about it. And still others know that there is work to be done, but are unprepared to have tough conversations with boys. We must recognize sexual violence as preventable behavior that a rising generation of boys can play a role in eliminating. Talking to girls about how to avoid violent men comes to us naturally enough, but history has clearly shown that placing the burden of prevention solely on them is inadequate. A more holistic approach involving the other half of the global population is needed to combat violence on a cultural scale. Sending unprepared boys into the world is not an option. We live in a nation where many boys will come to know victims, will know others who victimize, will be victimized themselves, or will knowingly or unknowingly commit acts of violence of their own. Few caretakers of boys want to think of their children as belonging to any of these groups, but the numbers guarantee that most boys will find themselves in at least one of them as they mature into adults. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention estimates that 18.3% of women and 1.4% of men in the United States experience an attempted rape or a completed rape in their lifetimes. And there are plenty of sources with higher estimates. We leave boys on their own to face this reality. No wonder many are baffled when faced with helping a survivor who confides in them or confronting a friend who brags about taking advantage of someone sexually. As a result of our inattention to them, most boys grow into men with understandings of rape that are so insufficient that they unknowingly pose a danger to themselves and others. They blindly accept the ideals of masculinity that are pushed on them, only to end up behaving, thinking, and speaking in ways that harm themselves and others. This can all take place without any ill intentions or conscious realization of what is going on. No boy is immune from sexual violence touching his life, even should he beat the odds and go through life without the companionship of someone who has survived or perpetrated sexual violence. He will still interact daily with a culture that produces and normalizes copious amounts of violence. How serious is sexual violence? How should we treat those who survive it? How should we treat those accused of perpetrating it? How should we respond to those who we know to have perpetrated it? Can it be prevented? And how? We daily cast our votes on these questions in the jokes that we tell privately, the conversations that we have at the water cooler, and the media that we choose to consume. Children and young adults are no different. If anything, they face unique challenges as they come of age in an increasingly hypersexual environment where evolving technologies are testing the boundaries of privacy and personal space. Peers, music, movies, social media, and pornography have countless things to tell youth about sex and the violence that arises in its context. Boys need to be taught that they are capable of talking back. This book will give you some perspective so that you are better prepared to initiate and navigate essential conversations to prepare boys for a violent world. I have spent the better part of the last 2 decades doing just that. I share my observations and thoughts with you in hopes that you will find the confidence to connect with the boys in your lives. The majority of this book is organized around key ideas that boys should learn. They are the lessons that I wish someone had shared with me when I was growing up. I have distilled usable tips where possible. Some are derived from research literature, some from my experience, and others directly from the mouths of boys. Chapter highlights are provided in order to remind readers of key takeaways. I also utilize additional appendices in order to provide further resources for those who desire backup for conversations with boys. Those resources include websites, other books, and some points of discussion that you may want in your back pocket. Some chapters are also accompanied by brief interviews that I conducted with veterans of necessary conversations with boys and men in order to provide perspective beyond my own. They are reminders that you are not alone. There is a global community working to end sexual violence that will someday, hopefully, include the boys who you know. I submit all of this with a particular audience in mind, the caretakers of, and most often the mothers of, Black boys. This has been the audience that has reacted the most passionately upon learning about my efforts to educate young men about sexual violence. I have met mothers struggling to understand their sons as sexual beings, and parents searching for resources to assist their sons in an ongoing war against youth cultures that promote disrespecting others, and women in particular. But I encourage fathers and male educators to step up as well, to lead by example, and to expand their own ways of thinking alongside their boys. I target Black boys not because I buy into myths that they are particularly violent or predatory, but because I feel an urgency to expand the limited resources for boys and men of color. I distinctly remember being a young initiate into anti-violence work and struggling to find the voices of other men who looked like me. I want to explicitly tackle the unique fears that Black boys share. Focusing on them is also in line with the wishes expressed to me by many of the parents, mentors, and caretakers who encouraged me to write this book. Many of them stated that the racial identifications of their children, either their self-identifications or the identifications that society imposed on them, were central to their understanding of how to prepare these children for the world. I am still confident that aspects of this book will relate to those who care for boys of all races, since American boys tend to be subjected to some recurring pressures regardless of their background. I have admittedly found the focus on Black boys to be a daunting challenge, because Black communities are by no means homogeneous. Boys who self-identify as Black do not have universal experiences and values. Understand that everything in this book may not pertain to the young men who you have in mind, but I do hope that you can find some materials that reflect the young men who you know. I want to highlight another admitted gap in my coverage. I have largely focused on heteronormative youth experiences. I have relied on my own perspectives as a heterosexual male, and the majority of my educational work has been with boys who identify as the same. I hope that others continue to expand the diversity in anti-violence literature, just as I am trying to do, and speak to boys who may see their experiences as materially different from the cisgender and heterosexual perspectives that dominate this book. Lastly, I disclose that I am not a child development expert or a child psychologist. I am not even a parent as of this writing. I am an anti-violence educator. But at the end of the day, I am just a guy who thinks that we can do better. Think of me as an embedded reporter, broadcasting from the front lines of a conflict for the hearts and minds of America's boys. The narrative that follows is ultimately a commentary about the state of manhood in our culture, and I submit it for anybody who might get something out of it. If you are invested in raising boys who are equipped to navigate a world where sexual assault is rampant but overlooked, then this book is for you. It covers issues that extend to every imaginable community of men. Every person who makes a conscious effort to oppose sexual violence, regardless of race, gender, sexual orientation, or any other demographic factor, makes a choice to step outside of the norms of culture that makes it far easier to ignore and excuse violence. I submit this contribution as one further reminder that it is not you who has lost your moral compass, but the world. I write so that the voices carrying this reminder will be more numerous and more diverse. If our voices continue to grow and diversify, one day we will find that we no longer stand against a culture. One day, we could be the ones controlling it. One thing is for certain. If that kind of social revolution is going to become a reality, it is going to require a generation of boys who are strong enough to share their voices. Chapter 1. Recognizing a Public Health Crisis. In my senior year of college, some like-minded men and I went on a tour of the southeastern United States during our spring break. We visited several institutions in order to teach audiences how men can help sexual assault survivors who disclose victimization to them, a message in service of a broader mission to reduce the troubling rates of sexual violence on our campus and elsewhere. Our first stop was a university in the Atlanta area, where we met with some of the school's faculty and staff. The audience thanked us after we presented, gave us some feedback, and discussed what it might take to get a similar group of undergraduate men working against sexual violence on their own campus. As we made our way out of the room, a woman whom I'd figured to be African American pulled me aside while my co-presenters headed off to figure out how to spend the rest of our afternoon. She disclosed that she had survived a horrific rape, the details of which no decent person could possibly defend. She then mentioned that there had been no criminal conviction for the incident. I was shocked. She had described an experience that no competent jury would possibly excuse, but told me that she had never even pressed charges. From what limited training I had on victim advocacy at the time, I knew it was common for survivors of rape to avoid criminal adjudication. I also knew that there were certain lines of questioning that one should generally avoid when listening to someone disclose victimization, such as prying questions that might imply judgment on a victim's decisions. The words that came out of my mouth in response were ill-formed, and I regretted them as soon as they came out. They simply reflected the first thing that came to my mind after hearing of the actions of a criminally violent man who was presumably still going about his business. I asked, "Why didn't you press charges?" She produced another shock with her answer. She said, "I never pressed charges because I wanted to protect you." This woman had been a complete stranger to me only an hour earlier. I frantically searched my memory in order to place how she knew me. My confusion must have been apparent. She clarified her statement without any prompting on my part and said, "I didn't press charges because I couldn't bear to see another black man in jail." It was the first, but definitely not the last, time that I would hear those words. I didn't want to further assault the black male image. I didn't want to tear the community apart. I didn't want to provide ammunition to racists taking aim at a successful black man. Whatever the language might be, the burden of black women taking one for the team eventually became all too familiar to me. That was one of my first glimpses into the network of black women who choose to bury their personal victimization for perceived communal good. I suspect that we would find these silent sisterhoods among most minority groups, all of them fueled by a belief that their community needs to be protected. One survivor who was raped by a stranger when she was 10 years old shared her experience in Dr. Charlotte Pierce Baker's Surviving the Silence and described the need to keep things behind closed doors as follows. "But now that I think about it, I wouldn't call the police because I wouldn't want to ruin his life. Him going to prison and being another statistic to me is almost as great an evil as what happened. I love black people, even when we're sick." I doubt that black women adhere to the practice of covering up men's offenses as often as they did in the past, but the practice survives nonetheless. Some of the women who shared their stories with me were advised to remain silent by friends or family, but others reached the conclusion to do so entirely on their own. They simply believed it was the right thing to do. Some people hear of women making decisions to remain silent and view them as misguided. They argue that these choices only serve to shield violent men who should rightfully be exposed. As I am not a survivor of sexual violence, it is impossible for me to truly know how I would react if I were victimized. So I do not see it as my place to criticize survivors for whatever responses they find most helpful. But I hope we can all at least agree that it is troubling that many women are forced to expend energy and spirit deciding how to respond to violence inflicted on them. The fact that so many women are forced to ponder difficult choices between healing themselves and healing their communities demands action. There is a debt to be repaid. Many who have shared their experiences with me over the years did indeed speak up publicly on some level. Some viewed holding their attackers accountable as a vital piece of their personal recovery. Others interpreted their duty to community to mean that they were to speak up so that others were not placed in similar danger. Some were simply seeking a community who could relate to their experience. Many of these women were people who I deeply respected long before I knew they were survivors of violence. Knowing this brought a special kind of inspiration for me, as I was in awe of the fact that these women carried memories of an intimate betrayal, but still chose to shine as mothers, professionals, students, and citizens. I still saw a debt to be repaid. I wondered then what I was supposed to do in return. If there is a reciprocal practice stitched into the souls of black men, I never learned it. How could I have, when I cannot recall a single conversation with my family, teachers, or coaches about sexual violence prior to my 20s? Now, Having had the opportunity to speak with many Black boys about sexual violence, I know that I am not an anomaly. No effort has ever emerged from Black men to match the continued sacrifices of Black women. Staunch defenders of Black men disagree. They cite repayment in the Black men who contribute positively to their communities, take care of their families, and never raise a hand to their partners. Those defenders would be correct in noting that the vast majority of men have never raped, beaten, or abused a woman. But they would be wrong in arguing that this is sufficient. To say that we have done our duty merely by not acting on the most repulsive of urges is a poor standard. We can do better. God forbid that we should apply similar logic to other areas of our lives. We do not think that we have done our best in school when we do not attack our teachers for assigning too much homework. And we do not think we have fulfilled our civic duties because we do not beat up the politician whom we detest. I do not know why we believe that we have dutifully responded to incessant reports of sexual violence by saying that we are not personally violent. As it stands, boys are allowed to grow into manhood without seriously considering how they should respond to the presence of sexual violence in the world. They have been trained to sit quietly on the sidelines of a crisis in which an estimated quarter of the women in America go through life with memory of being assaulted by a man in some fashion. We have trained them to respond to accounts of violence with ridicule and disinterest, unless someone close to them is crying on their shoulder or pleading his innocence. Much of my professional career has been spent working alongside educators and activists who daily think on sexual violence and how to respond to it. I have since left behind formal work in violence prevention and moved into a more conventional career. I am now constantly reminded that most people do not intentionally think about rape and sexual assault unless they have personally experienced violence or are close to someone who has. Thus, it is worth taking some time to review and define the problem. Let us start by coming up with a common definition of sexual violence. That is easier said than done, because every state defines rape and sexual assault a bit differently in their statutes. They do not even use consistent terms to label them. For anybody looking to review the legal definitions used by a particular state, I recommend a great resource put together by the Rape, Abuse, and Incest National Network, RAIN, that catalogs state definitions on their website. In addition to states providing a range of definitions, there are many other institutions in the business of defining sexual violence, such as schools and workplaces. Nonetheless, there are some common components of definitions that we can identify. Generally speaking, rape is defined as vaginal, anal, and oral penetration enacted against a person's will. This includes penetration with a digit or object. Sexual assault is any sexual contact enacted against a person's will. As sexual assault is all touching of a sexual nature that is done against a person's will, you can see that rape is a more specific form of sexual assault. Acts are typically defined as against a person's will if they are accompanied by force, threats, or intimidation. Policymakers are increasingly moving toward consent-based definitions of sexual violence. That is, they identify acts as violent if a participating party does not consent to them. Obviously, consent that is arrived at via coercion or intimidation should be understood by other parties as no consent at all. Please also note that intent and awareness from a perpetrator do not matter so much under consent-based definitions. A perpetrator could unknowingly commit a violent act by wrongly presuming that a partner has given consent. In Chapter 7, I highlight common misunderstandings of consent held by boys. Boys who lack a firm grasp of what consent means hold the potential to commit violence that disrupts their lives and the lives of others. Many of them rule out the possibility of violence if a partner is not physically resisting and screaming, "No." But they need to understand consent as the presence of a yes rather than the absence of a no. Most state laws and school policies go on to identify situations in which people are incapable of providing consent to sexual activity. For example, statutory rape laws indicate when a party is too young to consent to sexual activity with another person. An older party is required to understand that a younger party is incapable of providing consent, even if that younger party is willing to engage in sexual activity. The age difference required for a party to be unable to consent also varies from state to state. The aforementioned RAIN website also covers the ages at which people can consent. The other primary areas in which a person would be unable to consent are when a person has a permanent mental incapacity or is temporarily incapacitated and thus unable to communicate. Temporary incapacitation could result from a medical condition or the use of drugs or alcohol. For the purposes of this book, I consider rape to be vaginal, oral, or anal penetration of a sexual nature with a person who cannot consent or chooses not to consent. When I refer to sexual assault, I mean any and all touching of a sexual nature with a person who cannot consent or chooses not to consent. I collectively refer to both rape and sexual assault under the umbrella term of sexual violence. Now that we have established working definitions, let us get a sense of how often sexual violence occurs. Most studies researching incidence rates conclude that a quarter or more of women have been raped or sexually assaulted. Researchers at dozens of academic institutions and community-based organizations have turned up similar figures and measure the annual incidence of this violence in the hundreds of thousands. This means that if you were to sample four of your female friends or relatives at random, at least one of them carries or will carry a story of sexual victimization if statistics hold true. If you are skeptical of the output of academic institutions, we could also look to the campus sexual assault study published by the National Institute of Justice, which returned similar numbers. The study found that 15.9% of undergraduate women reported experiencing an attempted or completed sexual assault before entering college, and another 19% reported experiencing an attempted or completed sexual assault since entering college. There are, of course, some who experienced an assault both before and after college, so the aggregate number of women reporting an attempted or completed sexual assault was 28.5%. A sizable portion of prevalence research features college students given our access to these populations. But there is also the National Crime Victimization Survey administered by the U.S. Department of Justice for those looking for a broader snapshot. There is some criticism that the methodology of the survey leads to sexual violence being vastly underreported, but we can at least take it as a floor for how much violence takes place. There were an estimated annual 734,630 rapes or sexual assaults in the most recent iteration of the survey. While these numbers fall short of what we see estimated by some other sources, they are still considerable. It is still the case that boys will likely encounter survivors, even by conservative estimates. Decades of work from academic institutions, community organizations, and criminal justice agencies have given us an overwhelming body of research. We can safely conclude that sexual assault is a common experience for girls and women. This research does not generally include less severe forms of violence, such as a man copping a feel under the guise of playing around or flirting. We would come up with some truly astronomical rates if we were to capture all of the unwanted touching that women endure. Studies that take race into account often come up with even higher victimization rates for Black women. The Foundational National Violence Against Women Survey, conducted in 2000, concluded that 17.7% of white women and 19.8% of non-white women reported that they had experienced a completed or attempted rape in their lifetime. The Bureau of Justice Statistics has placed the rate of intimate partner victimization for black women as much as 35% higher than that of white women. Intimate partner violence refers to all violence inflicted by a current or former spouse, boyfriend, girlfriend, or partner. That includes murder, rape, sexual assault, robbery, simple assault, and aggravated assault. Before leaving statistics behind, I should note that sexual violence is an unmistakably gendered crime in that men represent the overwhelming majority of perpetrators, as they do for all forms of violence. This is fact, and no credible statistical source paints a different picture. Believe it or not, this is not a particularly controversial idea for most boys. They understand just fine that violence is largely a male arena by virtue of their own experiences. So, what is in the training of boys that makes us more violent than the sisters and female friends who are raised alongside us? This is one of many tough questions that we have to explore if we are to raise boys who will help turn around the sad statistics that I mentioned. I need to cover one final definition now that we have some common definitions in our toolbox. Rape culture is a term that I find helpful and adopt in this book. The term has been around since at least the 1970s, and here I use it to encapsulate the far-ranging behaviors and attitudes that normalize, trivialize, and condone sexual violence. Rape culture can be difficult to see because most of us were raised in environments where it was the status quo. If you are uncertain as to how to demonstrate rape culture to the boys in your life, consider that many of them already accept that there are brands of violence that are fostered by cultural supports. We saw this very clearly in the summer of 2020, when many of them connected with the protests for racial justice energized by the death of George Floyd after a police officer placed a knee on his neck for over 7 minutes. Let us consider some of the questions asked afterwards as communities wrestled with how to prevent more deaths. Some delved into locker room cultures that fostered hostility against the communities that police officers are to serve. Some criticized law enforcement training curricula for not focusing enough on techniques of de-escalation and community outreach. Some wondered if we should be celebrating television shows and movies that portray excessive force by officers as an acceptable means to an end. Some considered if law enforcement had too broad of a role in the first place and was simply being called on for tasks that it was unsuited to handle. Notice that all of the lines of inquiry that I just mentioned have one thing in common. They are not directed at the individual officers who were named as defendants in George Floyd's death. Rather, they are aimed at systemic and cultural processes. Sexual violence very much functions in a similar context. Simply put, it is not the work of a few bad apples, but of a far-reaching culture. Ultimate accountability rests with the perpetrators, but the rest of us play a role as well. Here are some commonly cited examples of behaviors that facilitate and/or excuse sexual violence. Pressuring young men to score. Expecting real men to be sexually aggressive. Catcalling and other behaviors that view women as sex objects more so than as people. Making statements such as bros before hoes in connection to violence that presume a party that is deserving of support. Dismissing all reports of sexual violence as false reports. Many see no connection between everyday behaviors such as these and actual violence. But remember that even conservative estimators measure the annual incidence of sexual assault in the hundreds of thousands. This is too high a rate for us to dismiss this violence as socially deviant behavior. It is normative behavior that our culture reinforces on some level. If you are still having difficulty detecting rape culture, then I ask you to think on a real-world report of sexual violence. Consider a past report that you have in your memory, or choose whatever case is dominating headlines at the time that you are reading this. You can choose a case involving a famous celebrity, or one that just received local attention. It almost does not matter which one you choose. I am confident that you will identify many of the same responses from the public. With your case in mind, think about if you heard any of the following ideas. 1. We expect real violence to come with definitive physical evidence. Many people insist on seeing rock-solid evidence before believing that an alleged perpetrator could potentially be at fault. Let us return to our consent-based definitions of sexual violence to see one of the problems with this mindset. Remember that sexual assault is sexual activity done without a person's consent. Consent, or the absence of consent, cannot always be uncovered via physical evidence. Sure, criminal justice personnel can find physical evidence that corroborates an account of what occurred, like bruises, bodily fluids, or ripped clothing, and they often do. But many people have an unrealistic depiction of the criminal justice system's ability to obtain this evidence. And even if they have it, it may not tell the full story. Just as consensual activity can leave behind bruising and tearing, non-consensual activity can fail to leave behind any evidence of force. 2. We expect real violence to be resisted and avoided by victims. People tend to ask questions of alleged victims such as, "Did she fight?" or "Did she scream?" In order to see the problem with demanding this kind of resistance, again, we have to return to our consent-based definitions of sexual assault. Physical resistance and verbal resistance clearly indicate that consent is not present, but their absence does not necessarily mean that consent is present. The actions of an alleged victim are largely independent from the question of whether or not a person has obtained consent before engaging in sexual activity. Whatever actions they have taken prior to an alleged assault are also irrelevant. For example, wearing a particular outfit, voluntarily going to a hotel room, consenting to some amount of intimate contact, consenting to past sexual activity. The only question that matters is whether or not an alleged victim consented to all of the sexual activity in question. Let us also not forget that, like with any form of trauma, people can freeze or shut down physically, verbally, or mentally upon experiencing violence. This would make it difficult for some to react in the moment or even fully process that they are experiencing a violent act. 3. We expect real victims to behave in certain ways. It is not just the actions that alleged victims take before and during an incident that come under scrutiny. Many criticize the behaviors that they take afterwards as well. For example, people might look at claims that an alleged victim has been intimate with another person after an incident and conclude that this means that he or she could not have been a victim because real victims do not behave like that. Or they might draw this conclusion from observing a person wait for years before reporting an incident. There are indeed some common reactions to sexual assault, and many great volumes have been written on the subject. However, it is still the case that there is no universal response to sexual assault. Human beings are complex, and their reactions to trauma are varied and inconsistent. Not to mention that many of the decisions that people cite as proof that an assault did not occur are actually very plausible reactions to an assault. For example, a survivor of violence may seek the intimate company of somebody that he or she trusts after experiencing an incident in which trust was violated. Or a survivor may be looking to regain control after it was taken from him or her. Likewise, a survivor could take months or even years to formally report an incident because he or she does not feel prepared to face outside scrutiny of a painful experience. 4. We expect real perpetrators to have no redeeming qualities. It is quite common to hear people defend an alleged perpetrator by claiming that he is a good guy without a known history of violence. The belief that most perpetrators are social deviants whose violent qualities are apparent to society is just not supported by research. Many of these men are otherwise able to function in society just fine. We cannot look to behaviors in other contexts to definitively ascertain if a violent act occurred. If there is a common thread to all of the aforementioned beliefs, it is that they distract from the issue of whether or not all parties consented to all sexual activity in question. They minimize the importance of ensuring consent in a world in which policymakers and adjudicators are increasingly, and I think rightly, identifying consent as the most important factor in determining fault. How an alleged victim fought back, how an alleged victim behaved afterwards, what kind of physical evidence was left behind, and whether or not an alleged perpetrator was a good guy are all secondary to the presence of consent. The four aforementioned beliefs come from an understandable place, but they have the effect of condoning behaviors that harm others. These beliefs collectively limit what we consider to be real violence. If we consider violence to be legitimate only when victims fight back against perpetrators who are previously known to be violent, when victims act as is stereotypically expected of them, and when they have the cuts and bruises to prove that they put up a fight, then we implicitly teach boys that all other behavior is nonviolent. Boys raised under these narrow definitions can be genuinely confused as to how they can be in the wrong if they consider themselves to be good people and are not faced with a sexual partner who is physically resisting them. They may also come to view survivors who do not behave as expected as undeserving of empathy. The statistics that I gave earlier in this chapter reveal that this is exactly what many of them do. If there is a silver lining to the way that culture indoctrinates young men into minimizing sexual violence, it is that learned behaviors are preventable. All social behaviors that are not fed by cultural acceptance eventually fade into obscurity. That includes what clothes are in style, the slang that we use, and whether or not we choose to pursue sexual activity without obtaining consent. The responsibility of preventing sexual violence should therefore not be heaped on handfuls of educators and advocates sprinkled throughout the country. Nor should we isolate it as women's work or as the obligation of concerned survivors of rape. This is community work. Many parents and guardians of girls are proactive about preparing them for a violent world. Teaching violence awareness is readily incorporated into the ways we raise our girls. When they are small, we might teach them the warning signs of predators or instill in them the confidence to speak up about unwanted touching. As they venture into adulthood, we continue to advise them on self-protective behaviors. We teach them not to lead men on, insist that they check in with us when they go out on dates, and tell them to watch how much they drink when out for the evening. Many women experience a lifetime of training on violence prevention, or rather risk reduction, but we will discuss this later. Conversely, many guardians of boys have told me that it never crossed their minds to talk to their boys about sexual assault. Others limited their conversations with their boys to teaching them how to avoid sexual predators when they were young. They then promptly abandoned the subject once they believed their boys were old enough to protect themselves. Now, the only time sexual violence might come up is in warning them to watch out for deceitful women who are out to get them. Those who did keep the conversations going often admitted that they did so with only a fraction of the energy that they spent talking to their girls about the same things. Sexual violence awareness is just not a natural part of the curriculum for the training of boys. It is true that boys are less likely to be victimized than girls. We nonetheless do them a disservice by not pulling them aside for important conversations, as sexual violence is still likely to touch their lives. Here are 5 reasons why boys should learn about sexual violence. 1. Boys are victimized. The most obvious reason why boys need to be at the table is that many boys will be victimized. The same studies that have exposed high victimization rates of women often show that men have their own troubling rates of victimization throughout their lifetimes. For example, the aforementioned National Crime Victimization Survey determined that 9% of all recorded victims of rape or sexual assault were males. Violence against men and boys often goes under the radar as compared to violence against women, but its frequency is astounding when viewed in isolation. As you might imagine, a significant amount of violence against men occurs when they are young. Children who experience sexual violence understandably report feeling confusion, guilt, and shame. We cannot expect them to accurately identify violence and report it without preparation. Furthermore, feelings of embarrassment do not disappear as boys mature into men, as there simply is not much precedent for men to share their experiences with sexual victimization. Resources dedicated to addressing barriers to men reporting are growing, though. 2. Boys know survivors. Up until now, I have discussed sexual violence in a pretty sterile fashion. I have captured it in statistics while largely ignoring the humans behind those statistics. However, each person who survives it is more than a number to be tallied. The survivors of sexual violence are friends, relatives, partners, and spouses who may one day disclose to a boy you know. Ideally, boys will have given some consideration to the nature of sexual violence before such a disclosure and will be prepared to help. The process of recovering from sexual assault is beyond the scope of this book, but there are many eye-opening accounts out there that provide insight into recovery. One common theme in recovery is that the reactions of those to whom survivors disclose matter. People are naturally uplifted by reactions of belief and support rather than skepticism and judgment. Boys should be educated in such a way that their default reaction to hearing of an assault is not to judge the victim or to tell her what she did wrong. When I first started in anti-violence work, I was surprised by how many female friends and relatives disclosed to me. I thought female survivors of male-perpetrated violence might not want to disclose to a man, but I now believe that people largely turn to those they trust, and that may include men. The boys you know will become trusted confidants to women close to them. This means that they may one day have the chance to help someone by treating a story of a violent encounter with the seriousness and respect that it deserves. 3. Boys know perpetrators. The majority of sexual assaults are committed by people known to the victim. They are committed by acquaintances, friends, dates, boyfriends, and spouses more so than strangers. If boys will come to know survivors, it then stands to reason that they will also come to know perpetrators. Perpetrators of violence will be included among their friends and family members. They do not generally come with flashing warning signs, but it is not unheard of for men to have some awareness of the sexual practices of those with whom they hang out. As such, boys can play a part in how their peers come to view the acceptability of their actions. Their reaction to a shared story, whether that story is told braggingly or portrayed as routine, could make someone reconsider their behaviors. In this respect, boys will have opportunities to actually prevent future violence. they should be prepared to do so. But this takes practice and is especially difficult for younger men who might be uncomfortable with voicing beliefs that go against their peer culture. 4. Boys are capable of violence. Preparing girls to detect and resist violent men assumes that there will always be violent men for women to avoid. That is likely true.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.